Tonight, The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich by William Shirer, Part 3.
Der Führer kommt!
Germany's warlord, Adolf Hitler, pays homage to the heroes of conquest, victorious generals who have extended his empire across a continent. For the Third Reich, it is a time of triumph and exaltation. Four years later, in 1945, grandiose dreams lie buried in the rubble of shattered cities. The Reich that was to last 1,000 years crumbles. The swaggering conqueror becomes bitter, sullen captive. Now the leaders of the war machine must face the retribution of a civilization they sought to demean and destroy. In the second year of the Second World War, Adolf Hitler is an adored hero in his homeland. Repeated military victories, swift and stunning, have silenced opposition. A blood bond has been forged between a militant messiah and his people. By the spring of 1941, the Nazi Empire and its satellites stretch southward from Norway to North Africa, across the scarred face of Europe from the Atlantic to the Baltic. Save for England, embattled but unyielding, Hitler is master of all he has coveted. Now Europe dances to the rhythm of a German waltz. The old world becomes a playground for uninvited tourists. Nazi overlords, there are rewards beyond conquest. Europe is stripped of its priceless treasures. By the trainload, they are sent to the Reich, earmarked for the private collections of Hitler and Goering. But wholesale looting of art is merely a prelude to a more systematic, more tragic plunder. Under the new order, civilians will starve so that Germans may be fed. Children will freeze so that Germans may be clothed. Living in darkness, surrounded by fear, for 150 million people, there is no refuge. A knock on the door may come at any time, bringing sudden arrest, brutal interrogation, internment in a concentration camp. Resistance is met by instant retaliation. The Czech village of Lidice becomes a monument to barbarism. In revenge for the slaying of SS chieftain Reinhard Heydrich by Czech patriots, Lidice is demolished, its men and boys massacred, its women and children sent to concentration camps. Remote from the suffering he has caused, Hitler secludes himself at Berchtesgaden. But the peaceful Bavarian Alps offer no refuge from a lifelong obsession. His dream of a Russian vassal state, rich in land, resources, and potential slaves, remains unfulfilled. All his energies are now directed against his paper ally, the Soviet Union. Meanwhile, the formalities of a false and uneasy alliance continue. Russian Foreign Minister Molotov visits Berlin for meetings that scarcely conceal mutual mistrust. Equal to Hitler in political intrigue, Molotov bluntly voices suspicion of German ambitions in Eastern Europe, refuses to be swayed by the Führer's repeated reassurances. But behind the diplomatic charade is a simple fact. Hitler has drawn up plans for an attack on Russia. Ignoring the warnings of his generals against risking war on two fronts, discounting Britain as a military threat, Hitler dictates the timetable for invasion, gives it the code name Barbarossa. Throughout the spring of 1941, the Germans move masses of men and equipment up to the Russian frontier. Despite Churchill's warnings, Stalin seemingly ignores the military buildup. On June 22, 1941, 140 divisions stand ready to strike. In less than a month, the Wehrmacht advances 450 miles into Russia. Moscow is only 200 miles away. As great land masses are swallowed up, so are entire Soviet armies. During the first weeks of Operation Barbarossa, tens of thousands of prisoners are taken, sustaining Hitler's faith in German invincibility. Across a 1,500-mile front, everything proceeds according to plan. In August of 1941, Adolf Hitler surveys the Eastern Front, confident the ravaged earth will soon be Germany's Lebensraum, its living space. Destiny itself seems to have pointed the way to Russia for his people. Hitler plays battlefield host to his ally, Benito Mussolini. Envying Hitler's success, the Italian dictator once more finds himself reduced to the role of admiring listener. Already, Hitler is planning a reduction of men and equipment needed for the Russian front. Toward the people of Eastern Europe, the Nazis pursue a policy of calculated brutality. Oppression ignites organized resistance among civilian populations. To crush opposition, the Nazis establish a simple mathematical formula. For every German killed, 100 hostages are executed. Autumn comes, and rain and mud, and still Moscow is not taken. The elements that helped defeat Napoleon now must be faced and fought by the Wehrmacht. By November, the army struggles against the harsh reality of a sullen Russian winter. For the first time, wounded return from the front, without brass bands or waving banners. They come from distant places with strange-sounding names, like Bialystok and Khimki, bringing with them an ominous feeling about the Eastern Front. In Germany, there is growing suspicion that the war is far from over. An army equipped for a four-month summer campaign sends back urgent appeals for winter clothing. Communiques tell of fighting in the outskirts of Moscow, but total victory always seems to be one battle away. On December 6th, Germany's traditional St. Nicholas Day, Soviet forces Hitler does not suspect exist launch a devastating counterattack across a 200-mile front before Moscow. For the first time, the Wehrmacht faces the prospect of retreats. But Hitler will tolerate no mention of withdrawal. Overruling his generals, he orders the army to hold its ground at any cost. In the next week, uncounted thousands die in the snows of Russia. Officers disobeying Hitler's orders are summarily dismissed or court-martialed. Somehow, the line holds. The army remains intact. But for the first time, the Wehrmacht has tasted defeat. December 11th, 1941, 4 days after the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, Hitler honors a commitment to his Japanese ally by declaring war on the United States. Hurling personal insults at Franklin D. Roosevelt, contemptuous of America's will and ability to wage war, he makes an adversary of the world's greatest industrial power. In the spring of 1942, fate seems to favor Nazi Germany. Waging all-out undersea warfare, German U-boats sink over 900 Allied vessels, threatening to cut off England's lifeline of food and war material. England's fortunes also seem foredoomed in the deserts of North Africa. General Erwin Rommel's famed Africa Corps has swiftly smashed through British defenses into Egypt. Now the Suez Canal and the great oil fields of the Middle East appear within easy grasp. Hitler's overriding concern, though, remains with the Russian front. From his new headquarters, Wolfschanze, Wolf's Lair, hidden in a remote forest of East Prussia, Hitler personally directs his armies against the Soviet Union. In the summer, the army launches a second great eastern offensive, this time through southern Russia. At first, the success of the previous year is repeated. Again, vast territory is taken and Soviet armies overrun. Now, an overconfident Hitler takes a reckless gamble. He divides his forces, attempting to capture both the oil fields of the Caucasus and a key industrial center, Stalingrad. Stalingrad becomes the focal point for two clashing armies. The name of the city becomes an end in itself. Germany and Russia pour in massive concentrations of troops, not only to win a military, but a symbolic victory. This forces the most bitter fighting of the war. The Nazis, who have overrun a continent at breakneck speed, can barely advance a single building at a time. But Hitler insists, where the German soldier sets foot, there he remains. Trapped by Hitler's refusal to order withdrawal from a deteriorating situation, the Wehrmacht begins to realize that this time, their fate is in the enemy's hands. During this period, Hitler's attitude toward the conduct of the war changes. Surrounding himself with a submissive general staff, he disregards logic, begins to base command decisions solely on emotion. As former German General Warlamont relates.
When later on, during the war, I was admitted at all to report personally to Hitler after inspections on the spot, he interrupted me at once, as soon as he perceived that I was going to deviate from his own views. And he even had his aides remove the maps I had brought along and statistical material from the tables without giving them the slightest regard. At that time, hardly anyone else could talk to him anymore who did not share his own views.
Another campaign begins, this one under the leadership of Heinrich Himmler, head of the dreaded Schutzstaffel, the SS. Conceived as a sacred order, the SS combines sadistic brutality with bizarre romanticism, an elite corps who replace all human values with allegiance to the doctrines of a Nazi superstate. Their prime task is to implement Hitler's racial fantasies, achieve a pure Aryan world. To this end, hundreds of thousands of unsuspecting people are herded into ghettos and relocation centers. In Warsaw, Lublin, Lof, Drancy, Cyprian, they wait, not knowing what to expect, what is to come. At a moment's notice, housewives, factory hands, professors, schoolchildren are shuttled across Europe on a nightmare journey to an unknown destination. Among these is the family of a young German Jew, Rudi Waxman, who today bears the tattooed credentials of his experience.
My mother was gassed in Auschwitz. My brother was shot in Mauthausen. My father was beaten to death in Hanover in my presence. 30 days before the end of the war.
Everything, including the war effort, is overridden by SS logistical needs. Arms and material for the front wait, as well as supplies for the people at home. German railroads are conscripted to cart human cargo across the continent. Subterfuge is maintained to prevent prisoners from rioting or escaping. Hundreds of thousands are told only that they are to be relocated. SS efficiency demands the maximum utilization of space. Cattle cars are crammed, stuffed with victims who scarcely have room to breathe. Concentration camps rise across the conquered lands of Europe. Auschwitz, Buchenwald, Dachau, Mauthausen, Treblinka. Each camp is a state within a state, deceptively complete even to dance bands and symphony orchestras. Within the confines of barbed wire and electrical barriers, prisoners are psychologically conditioned to passivity. To enable the few to control the many, SS overlords exploit the fear of death and the slim hope for life in a world where brutality is law.
Well, I recall one night, which I was questioned. I personally was hung by my wrists backwards. Your hands were tied in back of you, and then you were hung by your wrists. This causes extreme pains in the chest, resulting in a blackout. They would bring you to, question you further, until you blacked out again. This was only one of their methods. A most common sight was to witness prisoners ending their own lives simply because they could not make it any further.
From these camps, Germany's leaders planned to utilize prisoners for economic benefits. However, with 1 million inmates at any given time, the problem is immense. How to get maximum utilization of slave labor and maintain the camps at the lowest possible cost to the Third Reich? Exact cost accounting methods determine each prisoner's potential profit value to within a few marks. Companies such as IG Farben find camps ideal sites for profitable operations, like the giant Farben Chemical Trust, with a new plant created at Auschwitz. A number of internationally known firms are attracted by cheap slave labor. Labor kept in line by the SS and self-serving prisoner trustees.
My first day at work in Auschwitz camp number 3 consisted of taking part in the digging of ditches and laying cable. The prisoners were spaced 6 feet apart to carry cable on their shoulders. Running alongside the ditch were other inmates who were foremen and whose sole task it was to harass and kill the inmates working. The SS guards merely stood around and watched and made bets on it. As for example, I recall a foreman running up and hitting the prisoner right in front of me on the head with a rubber hose filled with steel cable, splitting his head wide open, killing him instantly. No particular reason, no reason at all, as a matter of fact. Just doing it as a matter of routine while yelling, hurry up and let's go. And you might as well do all you can because you're not going to survive anyway.
For those unable to work, of no economic value to the Reich, there is another fate. As camps are crowded to overflowing, greater selectivity is shown regarding a prisoner's value.
A lot of able-bodied women would hold on to their babies. Yet, we did not know it at the time, of course, the very fact that they held on to their babies doomed them, because the SS wanted to prevent disturbances, riots, any kind of problems, anything that could possibly develop into a problem for them. And would rather assure the people, of course, stay with your children. But the very fact that an able-bodied woman had a small baby and would not give the baby up immediately destined her to the gas chamber.
As the tempo of destruction accelerates, the mechanics of death become increasingly scientific. German companies eagerly compete for contracts to build gas chambers. So successful are their efforts that at one camp alone, Auschwitz, 34,000 people are exterminated in a 24-hour period. Deception is the ally of the SS, as unsuspecting victims are herded into gas chambers disguised as shower baths. Vast gas crematoriums efficiently solve the problem of mass disposal. Extermination is financially beneficial to the Nazis. According to Nazi bookkeeping, based upon the use of a victim's remains, income from labor, and any valuables, an average profit of 1,630 marks per person is realized. As human remains are measured in profit and loss columns, life in the Third Reich appears to go on in a normal manner. But it is the women, the very young, the old, who keep the economy moving. Conspicuously absent is an entire generation of young men fighting a seemingly endless war. November 1942. At the far limits of Axis conquest, in the sands of North Africa, Rommel's armies suffer a staggering defeat. Recoiling from fierce attack by the British Eighth Army, the Africa Corps retreats from Egypt, faces the threat of annihilation. Disaster strikes also in the frozen soil of Russia. Driven by their Führer to a hopeless defense of Stalingrad, 140,000 Wehrmacht troops die in vain. Now, on February 2nd, 1943, Field Marshal von Paulus surrenders the shattered remnants of a once mighty army. Atmosphere of growing unreality, it remains possible for Nazi leaders to push aside the omens of defeat, to lose themselves in the majesty of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. But for the would-be conquerors of Russia, 91,000 survivors of Stalingrad, there can be no escape from reality. For them, the aftermath of battle ends in a humiliating parade through the streets of Moscow, a march into captivity from which only 5,000 will ever return. Germany, as bitter fighting rages on all fronts, heroic war ceremonials continue. But the shift in German military fortunes is reflected in the somber faces of Nazi leaders.
Die letzten Stunden in den Trümmern von Cassino. Der Monte Cassino, ein Wellenbrecher, an dem monatelang.
In mid-1943, German newsreels cannot conceal the fact that despite stubborn resistance, Hitler's armies now are on the defensive. The Allies overrun Sicily, land in Italy, and push toward Rome.
Diesmal die Devise der Angloamerikaner. Neuseeländer, Marokkaner, Inder, Polen und Gaullisten.
For the German civilian, war is no longer a letter from the front, a dry communique in a daily paper. Allied bombers come by day and by night, devastating Berlin, Cologne, Munich, Frankfurt, Nuremberg. In Hamburg alone, following a single night's raid, 800,000 people wander the streets homeless. Powerless to prevent this destruction, Luftwaffe chief Hermann Göring falls from Hitler's favor. Joseph Goebbels becomes Hitler's alter ego, representing a Führer who refuses to visit his bombed-out cities. Despite steady onslaught from the sky, Nazi Germany displays a bond of solidarity between its people and their Führer. A poster proclaims, "Our walls may break, but never our hearts." On a lonely East Prussian highway, Adolf Hitler is greeted by his staff on his 55th birthday, April 20th, 1944. Official celebrations are held in Berlin, but Hitler insists on seclusion and safety from Allied air attack. It is June 6, 1944, D-Day. The greatest armada ever assembled comes to the northern coast of France to liberate a continent. Against fierce opposition, a beachhead is established. Within 3 months, these troops will race across France, drive to the borders of Germany itself. Allied success in Normandy breeds further resentment against Hitler among the officer corps. For years, their advice has been ignored. Now they face the long-feared two-front war against an enemy whose power increases daily. Many believe that immediate peace terms with the Allies is Germany's only hope for survival, and this possible only with Adolf Hitler deposed. Yet few are willing to challenge Hitler openly. In a Berlin apartment, a group of plotters is prepared to act, composed of army officers, lawyers, clergymen, politicians. Key figure in the conspiracy is young Prussian officer Klaus von Stauffenberg, who is determined Hitler must die. The site chosen for the assassination attempt is Hitler's headquarters in East Prussia, the day, July 20th, 1944, when Stauffenberg will be attending a high-level military conference. Stauffenberg passes easily through heavily guarded entry halls into the conference room. He places a briefcase containing a time bomb by Hitler's chair and leaves unnoticed. The explosion shatters the room, blowing out the walls and roof. Those near Hitler are killed or wounded, but the Führer escapes death, shielded by the heavy tabletop under which the bomb was planted. A few hours later, Hitler appears in public, shaken, one arm hanging stiff and useless. He describes his escape as a sign from the heavens favoring the Third Reich. But revenge remains foremost in his mind. And for the plotters, there will be no mercy. On August 7th, the conspirators are brought to trial before the Volksgericht, the People's Court. Stauffenberg has already been summarily executed. Hitler's favorite prosecutor, Judge Roland Freisler, presides over the court. Their fate already decided. The accused men must endure raging insults and obscenities. In a crude mockery of law and justice, all but a few of the plotters are condemned to death. The court will remain in session for months, grinding out death sentences, purging Germany of anyone considered anti-Nazi. At Berlin's Plötzensee prison, 8 of the condemned are slowly strangled by piano wire hung from meat hooks. By Hitler's command, the scene is filmed, viewed by him the same evening. August 1944. While German armies battle desperately to stave off invasion, Goebbels exhorts civilians to greater personal sacrifice to ensure final victory for the Reich.
Diesen Kampf mit wilder Entschlossenheit!
There is little left to give, but somehow the German will to fight persists. Through the organizational genius of his armaments minister, Albert Speer, Germany's war industry and Hitler's dreams of victory through miracle weapons are kept alive. Despite incessant Allied air attacks, Speer maintains production of needed war materials at 50% of peak level. Behind the impressive statistics is the fact that few replacements are available to man new equipment. Even the jet plane, a totally new concept in aviation, goes into production, but fuel and pilots are lacking. At the rocket experimental station, Peenemünde, lies another great hope of Hitler's crumbling Reich, the Geltungswaffen, the V-rockets Hitler believes will bring Britain to her knees. They launch a deadly new age in weaponry, but for Nazi Germany, they are developed too late. Dreams and experiments cannot conceal the sobering reality of retreat. On both the Eastern and Western fronts, the once invincible Wehrmacht stages a weary march back toward the borders of the fatherland. As they pull back, they destroy. Hitler has ordered a senseless policy that the earth be scorched without regard to military value. What must be abandoned must be destroyed. In the winter of 1944-45, mounting fear spreads through East Prussia. The Russians are fast approaching the border. All over Germany, civilians begin digging in for the defense of their homeland. In this atmosphere of crisis, there are bizarre sidelights. To build morale, Goebbels orders the making of a movie spectacular. Several army divisions and 90 million Reichsmarks are tied up in the film entitled Kohlberg. Badly needed soldiers fire blanks and face mock combat in a cinematic tribute to romantic militarism, Prussia's victory over Napoleon. The virtues of movie making notwithstanding, other measures must be taken to arrest the rising tide of defeat. A civilian army is formed, the Volkssturm. Schools, offices, factories are combed for boys and men between 15 and 60, as virtually every German now has the privilege of playing soldier in real life. Hitler returns to bomb-shattered Berlin on January 16, 1945. Here he will make his last stand, find his last refuge. Meeting with his beleaguered general staff, Hitler is harassed, his body racked by drugs given him by a quack physician. Hitler's living quarters, his offices, his apparatus for governing Germany, are confined to an underground headquarters at the Chancellery. The would-be master of Europe is reduced to a basement existence in the 18 small rooms of the Führer bunker. By March 1945, Allied troops have crossed the Rhine. The last great natural barrier in Western Germany has been bridged. Behind the rapidly advancing armies lies a liberated France and Belgium. In 6 weeks, Hitler loses one-third of his forces in the West. In the wake of the British and American advance, 325,000 men, including 30 generals, are taken prisoner. Even as the Russians draw closer to Berlin, even as disaster seems inevitable, Berliners still find ways to erase the war from their minds. In Berlin, soldiers who are little more than children are reviewed by their Führer. Manpower has become boy power, Hitler's last wishful hope for victory. April 21st, Russian armies reach the outskirts of Berlin. The siege of a great city begins. Red soldiers move from house to house, heading for the heart of Berlin and Hitler's chancellery. In the last photo taken of Hitler, he appears before the besieged chancellery with Martin Bormann, still dreaming of non-existent armies that would save his Reich. After 6 days of hard fighting, the chancellery falls to the Russians. Empty, shattered corridors, they search in vain for Adolf Hitler. All that is found are the charred bodies of Goebbels and his wife, who have poisoned themselves. Hitler's remains are never found. What happened to Hitler is told today in the ruins of the bunker by his personal chauffeur, Erich Kempka.
Ich hatte ihn gestern Abend noch gesund gesprochen.
On April 30th, early in the afternoon, Kempka was asked to bring 200 liters of gasoline to the Führer bunker. At the underground headquarters, he was told his boss was dead, that Hitler had just shot himself in the mouth. After the gasoline arrived, Hitler's doctor and two other men carried the Führer out of his room wrapped in a blanket.
Hinter ihm erschien in der Tür Martin Bormann und hatte Eva Braun auf den...
Behind them was Martin Bormann carrying Eva Braun in his arms. She had married Hitler a few hours before and was now dead too. Kempka took Eva Braun from Bormann and carried her outside, placed her beside Hitler. Then the gasoline was poured over the two of them and ignited. When the flames were blazing high, Kempka returned to the bunker. The thousand-year Reich is ended. The devastated cities of Germany are the silent graveyards of Nazi dreams. Now, Now the slaughterhouses are opened, and for the first time, the world sees the enormity of Nazi crimes. Like people waking from a nightmare, the Germans themselves become reluctant witnesses to all that happened. But why should they be surprised? 12 years earlier, they put in power a government that licensed brutality, that denied to some human beings the rights of their humanity, that built an assembly line for the murder of entire populations.
The wrongs which we seek to condemn and punish have been so calculated, so malignant and so devastating that civilization cannot tolerate their being ignored because it cannot survive their being repeated. That far greater.
In these words, America's Robert H. Jackson speaks for the conscience of the world. Tried before an international tribunal at Nuremberg, 21 Nazi leaders are indicted for crimes against humanity.
You must plead guilty or not guilty.
Bekenne mich im Sinne der Anklage nicht schuldig.
Für nicht schuldig.
Ich bekenne mich nicht schuldig.
To a man, they plead not guilty.
Im Sinne der Anklage nicht für schuldig.
Nicht schuldig.
Ich bekenne mich nicht schuldig.
But if they are not guilty, who is? And if they are, who is not? The German people who gave the Nazis power, the civilized world which permitted that monstrous regime to grow unchallenged. Hitler's Reich affirmed again that in every man there still exist the evils by which he can destroy himself. Blank as death, Dachau today is symbol of the camps that were the last terminal for uncertain millions. Among them, the 15,000 children of Theresienstadt. Of these, fewer than 100 survived. Yet doomed, knowing they were to die, they went about the business of children. Drew these pictures of butterflies and birds, dreamed of enchanted woods and kings and princesses. Amid horror, they kept a precious measure of innocence. Against death, they spoke for life.